why we try to get you to meditate. Amen. You want to meditate? Meditate the Word of God until the Word of God begins to what? Become a part of you. And you can begin to what? Amen. Regurgitate it, or speak it out, or pray it out, or confess it out spontaneously. It becomes secondhand once you begin to get filled with the Word of God. Now, anybody remember the story of Jonah when he was down in the depths of the sea? All right, so what did Jonah eventually do in the belly of a whale after going down to the depths of the sea? I mean, he was almost at the point of death. He was at the gates of hell. What did Jonah decide he would do? Let's turn there. So I'm just saying that whenever you get so full of the Word of God, whenever you get really saturated with the Word of God, when your spirit really begins to feed and feed and feed and feed on the Word of God, the Scripture says that the Word of God is life to them that what? Find it. And it's what? Healing to all of their flesh. All right, so it takes life, the life in the Word of God, to undo the heavy burdens, the yokes, the negative mindset, all of the negative programming that we have received. It takes the power of God. It takes the Word of God to counteract and to cause that negative information that we have received from childhood up to, you know, adulthood to be released from our subconscious mind. It takes the power of the Word of God. Okay, Jonah 2 verses 9 and 10. Somebody read that 7 through 10. Jonah 2, 7 through 10.
When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord. My prayer came unto thee, unto thy holy temple.
Mm-hmm.
They that observed lying vanities forsake their own mercy.
Mm-hmm.
But I would sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I would pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord.
All right, so Jonah was meditating. He was getting his believing what? Built up. He was full of the Word. Then finally he came to the point, he says that what? Amen. He began to what? Confess that whoever forsake, whosoever observe what? Lying vanities, what? Forsake the mercy of God. Amen. He began to what? Express what he believed down in his heart. He began to express. He began to confess the Word. And as he began to confess the Word, after he said, they that observe lying vanities forsake the mercy of God. Then he began to say, salvation is what? Of the Lord. He said, my salvation is what? Of the Lord. Okay, so whenever your believing is driven to the point, amen, to the bursting point, to the releasing point, to the point where you are what? Super saturated. When the Word of God becomes what? Really real. Amen. What's going to happen? You're going to what? You're going to begin to speak out. It's going to begin to what? Manifest. And it's going to manifest through what? A confession. Something that will be in agreement with what God, what you are believing for. Amen. In that particular situation. Okay, now, here is something that I want you to understand, that there is a correlation between your confession and the faith that you have in the Word of God. Sometimes people say, well, I don't have to say anything. Amen. Now, I think that many times we don't see the correlation, the necessity of going beyond the believing point. Everybody understand what I'm saying? Amen. We will spend much time, what? Listening, meditating, reading, mulling over, contemplating. Amen. But many times we say, well, I've done my devotion, I've read my Bible, I've meditated. But many times we don't understand the importance of the what? The confession side. Amen. Whatever we are believing, we need to what? We need to express, or we need to confess that. Amen. Now, I'm going to give you several things that confession does, but before I do that, I'm going to read the points that I have under B. Everybody have a handout? Everybody have a handout? All right, let's look at the God kind of faith is based on believing the word of God from your heart, not your head, and confessing the word with the word, with the mouth, God's word, which you believe in your heart. Okay, let's read it together. The God kind of faith
is based on believing the word of God from your heart, not your head, and confessing with the mouth God's word, which you believe in your heart.
All right, the God kind of faith is based on believing the word of God from your heart and confessing the word of God what? With your mouth. All right? Let's continue to read. Everybody. Faith is what? All right, let's read it again.
Faith is acting on what you believe in your heart.
All right, say it again.
Faith is acting on what you believe in your heart.
All right, the next statement, everybody take note. Your agreement with God's word expressed in the form of a confession is the initial action needed or necessary in the faith process. In other words, the only action, the first action that you make after you have believed, the first action that normally a person takes after they believe is to affirm or to say the same thing that God is saying about whatever you are believing for. We call that confession. That's the first action. And I'm wondering, do we look upon that as being, because the Bible says faith without what? Action is what?
Dead.
Okay, faith without what? Works or action is what?
Dead.
All right, do you think that most people consider saying the same thing that God is saying, or affirming the word of God, or coming into agreement with the word of God? All of it is saying the same thing. Do you think that most people view this as an action? Okay, Jesus said, stretch forth your hand, you know, that would be an action.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But do you view saying what God is saying, if God says that he bore your sickness and he carried your diseases, by his stripes you're healed, and after you have come to the knowledge of that, you began to confess that. You said, Lord, you said that you bore my sickness, carried my diseases, so I'm confessing my healing now. I believe that I am healed. All right, now do most people view that as an action? Sister Dorothy is thinking deep. I'm all okay. The brother's there. Now, because see, if you don't view it as an action, you know, the Bible says faith without what? Works is dead. If you don't view it as an action, then you're not going to put any what? Any value on that. And you're not going to do it.
What was the question?
I'm sorry.
All right, somebody tell their story. I can do it, but I want somebody to. I want somebody else that got what I said.
Do you view confessing the word as action?
So I'm agreeing with God. You know, you say, I'm believing God for my finances.
And you say what the word
maybe
says.
Maybe you use the scripture, my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory.
Yes. Question.
Yeah, do you feel that most people feel that they need to affirm that or say that or come into agreement with that? And if they do they look upon that as an action that you are taking to make your faith manifest in that area?
Do most people think that of that?
Do you feel that the average believer?
I think they do.
Okay.
Because most times when they
if they confess it, they believe it's going to happen.
Okay.
You know, but, and they think that's all they have to do until they're taught that.
Right, okay. I think that that's very good. Now, we want to know, do you feel that most people look upon that as an action, or do they think that there are other actions that perhaps are more important? You know, there's got to be, you know, it's got to be more than saying it or agreeing with it. There are going to be other actions that we're going to have to what? Submit to or obey or demonstrate in order to bring God's promises to pass in most areas. It's going to be a series of things you're going to have to do.
I think the confession, I'll say it. I think the confession is maybe a passive action, and when you actually do it, it's action. That makes sense.
Okay. All right.
It's still action.
But I never thought of it until you just brought it up. I mean, I confess the word, but the question was, did I see that as action?
Taking action, right, on the word, right.
And I would not have, until you brought it up, I would not have
thought of it. Okay.
But.
Okay. That's good, because if this action is not the initial action, more than likely, you're going to be kind of slow, because this is the thing that kind of gets you into the action mode to believe for the promise that you are believing God for to come to pass. There's nothing that can motivate you like saying what God says. And that's the reason why many times in prayer, that's one of the best ways to confess the word when you're praying. Always stick with what God is saying about whatever you are believing for. Just say it. Let's come into agreement. God, you say that you bore my sickness, you carry my diseases. Lord, you said that your promises are sure to every seed. Your covenant, you said you would never break it, neither alter the word that has gone out of your mouth. Is that a statement of a faith? It is, okay. So we're trying to get over, because there's some reason why many in the body of Christ are so, I mean, this is the struggle they have even in faith institutions. It's difficult to get people really established in agreeing with God in His Word or confessing. It's easier to get people to believe because you can just hear teachers, you can read information, read books, listen to tapes, and you're going to believe if you get enough information. You're going to believe. You're going to get established in what? In believing something that you are constantly hearing about. But to confess the thing that you believe in is another story altogether. So that's the issue that we're having tonight. How important do we view agreeing with God in our confession? How important do we view that? What value are we attaching to that?
I think it's
frontline defense. Okay. Everybody kind of quiet on that issue. Okay, now y'all can talk, because I got several things that confession does. You'll be shocked to know the things that confession actually releases in your life. Anybody want to say anything about it? You don't have a whole lot of people say, the Lord is the strength of my life. Woo! Greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. All right. You don't hear a whole lot of that, do you? But kind of tone it down. All right. Why do you think that's so? Jonah didn't stay quiet, right? Jonah didn't. what did we mention? Jeremiah. Jesus said that out of the abundance of the heart, what? All right. Alright, let's keep reading, maybe we'll get it up a while. Alright, let's look at number two. Everybody together, your words are your what?
Faith.
Alright, read that again.
Your words are your faith.
Let's keep reading.
Your lips give expression to your faith, and your tongues will proceed.
Alright, let's read that again.
Your lips give expression to your faith, and your tongues will proceed.
Alright. It's the confession, let's read it together, it's the confession of your lips that have grown out of faith in your heart that enables you to defeat the adversary and out of everyday circumstance. All right, okay, let's turn to these scriptures here. These scriptures might help us. Isaiah 57:19. I tell you one thing, if we would be heard verbally, confessing the word in our prayer, or just praying the word, I guarantee you, you would begin to experience some miraculous things. Isaiah 57:19. I hope I have the right scripture. All right. Everybody together, what does that say? I do what? Okay, God said, I create the what? Fruit from the lips. In other words, it's the mouth of the righteous man that what? Of the upright that causes him to be what? Delivered. Everybody agree with that? The mouth of the upright is the thing that causes you to experience deliverance. Okay, there's a Revelation scripture that says something basically the same thing. Revelation 12, what is it, 11? Anybody remember that? The mouth of the upright shall deliver him. God said, I create the fruit of the lips. All right, I create the fruit of the lips. Okay, what does that say? I create the fruit of the lips. I create the fruit of the lips. What is that saying? So many words.
I will give you the information that you need to speak. I will tell you what to speak.
Okay. Right. Anybody else? I create the fruit of the lips. That's what God says. He's just waiting for you to what? Speak it.
So whatever you speak.
All right.
If it's in faith.
Right, speak it in faith.
It's not in the word.
Right.
And you still speak it. That's fruit that you still get.
Right, okay. So matter of fact, lab it and grab it, huh? Name it and claim it. All right, so God is waiting for your words, because believing alone is not going to what? Give you the results that you are seeking. Believing alone is just half of believing and confessing is two sides of the same what? The faith process is not complete until you what? Believe it and then what? Speak it. Everybody's, amen. Believe it and what? Speak it. All right. Right, everybody, Sister Hill? Okay, let's look at Proverbs 12:6. Let's read that. One of the best sources for getting established in this area of speaking would be the meditation book under the authority of God's Word and the authority of the believer's word. If you've got a meditation book, we have a lot of scriptures under that particular heading. Okay? Proverbs 12, 6. Let's read that one together. Proverbs 12, 6. What does that say?
The words of the wicked are like the blood, but the mouth of the upright shall live.
All right? The mouth of the upright shall what? All right? Let's look at verse 14, the same chapter. And read that again. All right, so you will always what? Get whatever you what? Say. So if you want to experience good, then you have to what? Speak in line with what? God's word. Okay. All right, 13:2, let's read that one. Chapter 13, verse 2. Okay, Revelation 12:11, let's read that one. Okay, let's look at number 3, everybody together. Your success and usefulness in the world is going to be measured by your what?
Confession.
And by the tenacity with which you hold that confession under
all circumstances.
Okay. All right. So Hebrews 10:23, let's look at that one, and then we'll look at verse 35 and 36. Let's read it very quickly. Okay, Hebrews 10:23, let's read it together.
Let us hold fast to the confession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful.
All right, let us hold fast our what?
Confession of our faith.
Okay, let's go to verse 35. Everybody, cast not what? Okay. Okay, so you see there that you have to hold fast to the confession of your faith, because many times there will be a lot of adversity, a lot of adverse conditions that will prevail that will almost make you what? Shut up. Or change the tune of your what? The tone of your what? Confession. And so you have to understand that you got to stick with it, hold fast. The Bible says we are made partakers if we hold fast the confession of our faith steadfast all the way, what? To the end. All right, number 4, the fourth point I want to make, this is the last one. Let's read this together. Let me just read it. Simply reading the Bible, meditating on the word, will not build faith in itself. Okay, anybody got any response to that? Simply reading the Bible, meditating on the word, will not build faith in itself. That is a startling revelation. Reading the Bible or meditating the word will not build faith automatically by itself. no faith comes by hearing. But there's another component to what? Faith that you have to add to what? The believing. Right? And that component is what? You got to what? You got to speak out. You got to what? Confess or affirm the thing that you are what? Believing. Amen. You know, I'm not sure whether we're getting this or not, but I do know that this is a problem in the body of Christ, that we are really holding back a lot of our blessings because of being slow. And the way that you can very easily begin to practice confession is that when you pray, begin to pray in line with what? The Word of God. You begin to praise the Lord. Begin to what? Praise the Lord in line with what? The Word of God. That's a good way to really perfect your confession by praying and praising in line with the Word of God. So, this is a very important statement, because many times people believe if they would read the Bible, that it will automatically build them up in faith. If they will meditate the Word of God, it will automatically what? Make them strong in faith, even without what? Coming into agreement with it, or affirming or saying the same thing that God is saying with your mouth. Okay, let's continue to read that. It will build the capacity for faith, but faith is built. Everybody, look at this. Faith is built when the Word becomes a what? Part of our what? All right, a part of our what?
Daily news.
And part of our daily what?
Speech.
And our conduct, or as we what? Act on it. Okay, so I want you to keep that in mind. Okay, so anybody got any comments on that? It will build the capacity for faith. Reading the Bible, meditating the Word of God will not build faith by itself. Amen. You can read the Bible and meditate 30 years and you still won't be healed. You still will be poor. Because you, at some point you got to what? Open your mouth and what? And begin to what? Say something, right? Amen. You got to open your mouth and what? Say. Everybody says say something.
Say something.
Okay.
Okay. It's almost like if the end's health. If I were to read the book on how to have a great physique and read about if I go to the gym and do 3 sets, if I eat right, and if I just read that every day, and thinking just because I read it, I'm going to get the results, it doesn't happen. But when I make some action and say, I'm going to go to the gym in the morning, I'm going to do these sets, I'm going to actually do it, that's kind of how we have to look at the Word of God. Read the Bible, just because you read it doesn't happen, but once you begin to take what you read and begin to apply it daily, then you begin to get results, tangible results from it. So.
That's good, that's good. Now we just had a big dinner this evening, and we had catfish and candy yams and the whole thing. It was good. Now, when we that's the only thing y'all related to today. Okay, now all that food was spread out there. We could have said, "Oh, I really believe that this food is good, and if I eat this food, it sure will nourish my body." Oh, I really believe in this food. Oh, I believe this food really is good. I believe if we eat this food, or it will really nourish us. We'll feel better. We'll get strong. Okay? Okay? So that's the believing part, right? Now, if we never partaken of that food, never got the plate, put the piece of fish on there, put the green beans on there, and put the candy yams on there, so forth and so on, that is the what? The action part. Okay? And after we what? Took it and began to what? Partake of it. Then that was the action necessary in order for us to receive what? Our nourishment from that particular food. But because we could have stared at it all evening and it still wouldn't have benefited us at all. nobody would have been what? Nourished? Nobody would have been what? Full. All right. So we had to partake of that in order for us to receive life. Okay. Now.
So isn't that that last step, what's so often missing, the action part, and whatever we do, that's the part where, like we were saying last week, that's the biggest challenge, the action part. And what'd you say?
Yeah, I believe that. Okay, the action part is the most difficult, but I believe that even before a lot of action, I feel that we've got to get comfortable with what keeping the Word of God in our mouths to. We've got to get comfortable with that. Many times people draw back by making confessions because confessions call the things that be not as though they what? Actually, you're saying something that you don't really have in what? In reality. Right? You have it in the faith form of it, but you don't have it in the what? In the manifest form.
But when you confess it also, it put the wheels in motion and action for you to prompt you to begin to do something.
Yeah, it will prompt you to do whatever you have to do in order to get that thing, you know, being manifested.
I think it would make some deal, some commitment, and you do some responsibility in you that I have to make sure that I'm doing what I'm supposed to do as well. So if you say
that's
it
right,
with an expectation,
mm-hmm,
I think God requires something of you as
yes,
well. So
that's right.
You know, you can't just speak some of those more comfortable scriptures,
mm-hmm,
you know, every form gives me a problem.
Right.
But you can't be going off doing something else. So it puts some responsibility on you, so maybe we're less likely
right,
to, even though we know it, we've read it, because we have accountability
for
ourselves
after
we've all said it.
There you go, there you go. Okay, so everybody agreed that calling the things that be not as though they are is a little challenge? Right.
Yeah.
Okay, Sister Denise said the average believer is what? Too lazy to what?
Right.
You get
consistent in your
profession
and then
stay in.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
I read your book.
I read
your book. Yeah. I mean, she's right. She's lazy. You know it's there. You
yes,
get the book
out. Okay. This is all we have time for today. But I know that we got to do a lot more work in this particular area. A lot more, because this is the area that helps to what? Loosen all of the negative, build up all the negative mentalities, the negative life experiences. This is the thing that releases us from all of the negative past that we have experienced. And if we don't begin to what? Agree with God, then it's not going to be released. Our minds will not be renewed. All right, so. All right, that's basically all we have time for. If we have time Sunday, we'll begin to give you several things that confession actually accomplishes in the life of the believer. What confession actually accomplishes. Okay.